Hello, everybody. Welcome back to the Hearthstone Championship Tour, America's Winter Championship. We're about to jump into the last matchup of the day. We're here at the sidebar. I'm joined by Cora and Rob. I want to get your guys' thoughts real quickly. Cora, were you expecting this much control going into the weekend?
I was not. And I think I said it on the caster desk a couple of times. It's very surprising. We predicted more aggressive decks, more patron as far as control warrior, but I'm pleasantly surprised. I think it's unexpected, but it's not a bad thing at all.
All right, well, let's start talking about the next match here. We're going to introduce our first player for the last match of the day, hailing all the way from Argentina. It is going to be Snail. All
right, so Snail, obviously the winner of the Tavern Hero event in Argentina. One of these players who's coming in with kind of a lot riding on him. He's not necessarily super confident about what he's bringing to this, but he's a player who's looking to prove himself, and he wasn't even going to go to the America's Winter Preliminary. Was actually spurred on by his girlfriend and told, you know, hey, you can do this. You should go. Traveled 2 hours to go to it. One of the definite underdog stories here, and I'm really looking forward to see what it brings.
Yeah, definitely. Well, let's go ahead and introduce his opponent. It is going to be Chess Dude.
Chess Dude, only 17 years old, plays in the top 1% of all chess players in the world. I mean, this guy is talented.
Yeah, and we'll see if that chess skill translates into Hearthstone, both heavy decision making, and I really like his name, super creative. He plays chess, he's a dude, he's Chess Dude.
Not a lot of bells and whistles to it, huh?
Yeah. But yeah, these two players are relatively unknown, even in their regions, like Snail in Latin America and even Chess Dude in North America. They're both very unknown. So we had the chance to sit down and talk with them, and they told each other that even though they are unknown, they're definitely not going to underestimate each other. So let's see what they had to say.
My first match this weekend is against Chess Dude. Chess Dude is definitely a pretty smart kid. I don't know much about him, to be honest, but at the same time, he probably knows less than me.
My first opponent, Snail, I definitely think he's a very good player. To have come this far in the preliminaries definitely is not easy, and you know, you have to be a good player to get this far.
I know Chess Dude is new to tournaments, but I don't really think that has anything to do. If he came this far, it's because he's a really good player like everyone else here.
It seems like he's mostly an aggro player. You know, as a tavern hero, to be able to come this far definitely shows that he does have a lot of skills in this game.
I think he's a really good player, but I think my biggest fear is my nerves.
I'll always come into every match with the belief that I have the ability to win, and you know, I will win.
I get really nervous in this kind of high-pressure environments.
One important lesson that I've learned over the years of playing chess is you should never be intimidated or afraid of your opponents when you're coming into a match. When I started playing chess tournaments, I would be very scared, and I'd be like, he's probably better than me at the game, and I'm probably gonna lose, so I'll play very defensively and try to make a draw. I've learned that that is definitely not the correct mentality when you're coming into a competitive tournament. You always have to be confident that you're going to win the game. I look forward to playing him.
We'll see.
Welcome back to the fourth and final match of the day here at the Hearthstone America's Winter Championships. I am Sotil, joined here once again by the analyst dream team of Reynard and Savitz. And the game we are about to watch is Chess Dude versus Snail. Guys, any thoughts on that video we watched? Chess Dude seems a pretty laid back, confident guy. Seems like he's here to win, do well.
Yeah, I mean, he's definitely the one with, I guess it's a little bit more used to that tournament setting, even if it is in a different game. And I mean, that definitely helps. I mean, Snail mentioned himself, he's a little bit concerned about the nerves. And I mean, we'll see if he can overcome that and just play the same way that he would play from home.
Yeah, Savitz, Snail definitely painted himself as an underdog. And I think, honestly, that's a fair assessment. He is here as the Tavern Hero when we looked at his overall stats in comparison to the other people. They are a little bit lower as well, so.
Yeah, he might have played a little bit less than some of the other players. So definitely an underdog, but he does have a chance here. And about Chess Dude, I think it's really cool to see him play Rogue here. Rogue is his favorite class, and almost half of his games in ranked play are with Rogue, so it's kind of his signature deck.
Yeah, absolutely. And he is going to lead out here with the Rogue. Looks like it's up against a Patron Warrior here from Snail. Inner Rage, the dead giveaway. Sludge Belcher, a card that's come more into the deck recently, but there you go. Battle Rage and Shredder as well. So how do we feel about this matchup, guys? Starting with you, Reynard.
It can honestly go either way. I would give a small edge to Rogue, but it's definitely anyone's game. I mean, the key cards here for the Warrior are definitely going to be Deathbite.
Yes.
And the key cards for Rogue, like a lot of its matchups, would have to actually Blade Flurry, right? That's the way you deal with the big board of patrons and just be able to deal with kind of a warrior swarm of minions. No.
Yeah. Deathspite just so incredibly efficient against Rogue's openings. You can use it to take out a 3-drop, a Farseer, or an SI agent, for example, and then it's there, sat around, shutting down the potential Violet Teacher follow-up afterwards. So yeah, hugely important card for the warrior to have.
Yeah, we've been seeing a lot of that control warrior, but good news for Chess, dude, this is not one of those control warriors, but it's instead going to be a patron. So it's a little bit easier because there's slightly less removal for the threats from his side, and that Blade Flurry is so efficient with a poison or oil at clearing the Grim Patrons.
Yeah, right off the bat, both players actually have a great draw. I mean, Snail has the Deathbite that he needs. He has that Battle Rage where if his minions happen to live for a turn, he manages to, you know, keep the gas flowing, draw multiple cards. That's really important as the Patron Warrior. It's very easy to run out of cards otherwise. And he picked up Dread Corsair, which, you know, along with that Deathbite Battle Rage, is going to just free roll a card. The Rogue has coin. That's a huge deal. Every game that you get coin with the Rogue deck, it helps quite a bit. It's going to enable plays like turn 3 4 drops, coin SI agent, which, you know, admittedly not too relevant in this matchup.
Right.
Great to have that nonetheless.
Yeah, Snail, they are considering playing the Unstable cooldown down too, but chooses in the end to not do it just yet. Thinks that there's going to be more value in it later on. And I kind of agree.
Yeah, interesting because Snail did mention that he feels his biggest enemy is possibly his nerves. So there's two possible reactions to that, right? You can, if you don't get it just right, your two traps that you can fall into are sitting back and overthinking everything because you're too worried, or just getting into this rhythm where your nervous energy is making you play too fast.
Oh, yeah.
And interesting that see him take a very, very slow turn two there. So it'll be interesting to see it. Keep an eye on just how that develops, whether the nerves are playing a part here.
That's actually quite common for people who are playing on the stage for the first time when they're nervous, that they're playing too quickly. And it's one of the things when I get asked what would be my advice for somebody who's playing on the stage for the first time. And the advice that I'm giving them is the rope turn one. Just take it easy. Just like remember that you have all the time in the world. You don't, well, until the rope burns out, but that's still a lot of time. So just take your time, take it easy, and take it slow in the first game.
Well, Snail definitely taking advantage of the rope this turn, something we should definitely talk about, because this turn he has a million options, and all of them are very important. So he's going to opt for developing the weapon and playing Dread Corsair and not attacking. Or no, he is attacking. Okay, I like that play. So I'm a big fan of playing War Axe. I like the fact that he attacked, because he knows he wants to get that Deathbite out right on time for Azurdrake. And, you know, to set up Deathbite for Grim Patrons potentially as well. Mm-hmm. Playing the Dread Corsair, it's an option available to him. A lot of times when somebody's playing a Hearthstone at a high level, one of the key things is mana efficiency. So if they have a mana available and a minion that they can play, they're going to do it.
Yep.
But one of the reasons that Grim Patron is such a high skill cap deck is that it's not necessarily always right to play your cards in these cases. When you're playing against Rogue, the deck is literally a pile of removal and some minions. So that Dread Corsair is just not living. There's no way it's living. Whereas had he held it for Deathbite, he would have guaranteed cycled it off of Battle Rage. Whereas now what he did with it is basically use it as a one mana, kind of like Flame Imp with no drawback. So this is like a very easy trap to fall into.
Yeah.
And in the case of it living, it's not necessarily a mistake, but I think it's just very unlikely that it lives against Rogue.
Yeah, I don't even playing it there for one mana, you know, is questionable. Sometimes even when you have it in zero mana with a Deathbite equipped, it's still correct not to play it because it's a zero mana direct activator for Battle Rage on the following turn, as you said. So yeah, one of the huge nuances to Grim Patron Warrior is that it's not just a curve out deck where you just have to fill out your mana curve every turn and try and put the pressure on, but sometimes you do have to get more creative with how you use your cards and understand their purpose and to how they develop your ongoing game plan.
Another Deathbite getting picked up by Snail. Such a great card. Maybe even the best card, or one of the best cards in the Patron Warrior, but when you already have one, it's a little bit tricky to get full value out of both of them.
I'm a big fan of Snail just dropping that War Axe turn 3 and attacking two turns in a row with it. I mean, that is a play a lot of people are a little bit scared to make, because if you're used to playing Control Warrior, you know, you want to save that weapon as removal. But he realizes he has a lot of durability. Patron's a much more aggressive deck than Control Warrior, and you just want to get those charges out.
Yep, Chess Dude here going for the Drake first, hoping to pick up a backstab to go with that spell power from the Drake to be able to take out the front half of the Shredder easily. Does not find the backstab, so now he's going to have to use the weapon.
Yeah,
most likely. He could want to hold on to it because it's Flurry, though.
Chess Dude had the option there to play Violet Teacher. What do you think, Sottled? What are the advantages of Drake versus Violet Teacher?
Yeah, I mean, I was definitely looking at the Violet Teacher, but it looks like the Deadly Poison.
No,
the Violet Teacher was drawn off the Drake, right?
Yeah. This is probably
my mistake. Yeah.
But anyway, as you just saw a pop up on screen there for a second, Chess Dude, Savitz, you mentioned he's played over 50, or nearly 50% of his total games with Rogue, and he has an over 60% win rate while playing Rogue. So it's a huge sample size, something like 3,500 games of Rogue, I think, to run at 60% is kind of crazy. And the Patron, as we now see, has come into hand from Snail. So those Death Spites in his hand have suddenly become the party starters here, and he's going to be able to follow them up very quickly. But as long as that Deadly Poison is equipped from Chess Dude, there is always going to be the threat of the Blade Flurry, and I love him not attacking that Shredder that is in play on the previous turn, because he knows the key to this matchup is that Deadly Poison Blade Flurry.
Yeah, Chess Dude is already so low in HP. Wow, that Fiery War Axe early on really helped out with dealing the damage.
Yeah, that second Deadly Poison picked up, though, means that Chessy does have access to a way to deal Patron all over again, so might see him make that attack this turn.
All right, so this time are we going to get the backstab? Nope, still no backstab to deal with that Shredder. So, but as you said, the second Deadly Poison being picked up does give him the security, but now just wailing on this Shredder with his face is going to put him in trouble anyway, and he still chooses to hold on.
That's maybe the best card in Snail's entire deck after Deathbite against Rogue. It's so good at just locking up the board after you have a lead. And at this point, Snail has Chess Dude at a very low life total. He has a huge lead. I mean, it's very rare that you would have a minion stick around for this long. I mean, I fully expect him to take advantage of this Lothab draw and try to close the game next turn.
Yep, but he's going to... He wants to damage the Lothab for the Battle Rage for next turn, I would guess.
Yeah, so I mean, this is insurance. Okay. If he doesn't have lethal next turn, then he can at least activate the Battle Rage. Obviously, Lothab is locking out most of the clean removal options, so he doesn't see too much harm in injuring it. And with that Battle Rage, this gives him an alternate plan if the initial plan of just pushing the pressure through doesn't work.
Yeah, Chess Dude gonna play both SI agents. The only real play he has here to try to reduce some of the damage. And pray for a small minion out of Piloted Shredder.
Or like a Doomsayer. Would the guy also work? Because then that Lothab would not be going to face it. Oh! Fieldhouse Mana Storm, that's lethal right there with the Death Spite.
Welp.
Calculated.
Wow.
Snail playing towards his Millhouse out.
Yep.
Takes a clean game off of Rogue. Normally this game's a lot more back and forth, I would say, in this matchup, but yeah, just a really strong draw from the Warrior, and Rogue just couldn't really find like a backstab or anything to slow it down.
Yeah, so Snail, as the underdog, is going to go out to the one-game lead here, and I guess it's important to point out, you know, this is a guy who's played less Hearthstone than everyone else here, and operates at a slightly lower win rate based on his statistics, but what matters is, now that he has the opportunity to take Hearthstone seriously, there's every opportunity that he's stepped up his preparation, he's stepped up his practice, and what matters is, how good is his lineup here on the day? How well does he perform here on the day? Has he made the right meta calls for this tournament? Everything else is in the past. What matters is right here and right here and now. He's already winning.
Yeah, I mean, he's off to a great start. He knows he was brave enough, even though we've talked about it, that he might be a little bit less experienced than some of the other players in the tournament. He was brave enough to bring the Grim Patron Warrior, which is often considered one of the most difficult decks to play.
Yeah, and speaking of Snail, he has faced multiple challenges leading up to this event. We had a chance to hear a little bit about him, so let's take a look at that right now.
My name is Santiago Iotti. I'm known by Snail. I'm 25 years old, and I'm from Argentina. The esports scene is a lot smaller in Latin America, but it's growing really quickly. We're catching up. Argentinians are really like passionate about sports and even esports. In my case, I have to travel 2 hours to go compete in the LAN events, like the Father's Side gatherings and other tournaments. The connection where I live is not really that good, and that is a problem. For example, I can't stream. Like, I have the best connection possible there, and I have like 256 kbytes of upload. That's terrible. Yeah, I can do pretty much nothing. Being here is a dream. I never thought I would be here. I felt like I was the underdog in the qualifier, and I still feel like I'm the underdog here. When I was going to compete in the qualifier after winning the Torn Hero, I was like, I don't know, just going to have fun, let's say. Torn Heroes are supposed to be skill-wise lower than the other players. After the first day, I was really like proud of myself and like, maybe I can do this. I came this far, I can't stop now. Of course, nobody was expecting me to do that fine, not even myself. I beat a lot of amazing players that I used to admire. I still do. of course, the Argentina committee was all happy. You know, I received a lot of messages from people from Chile, from Uruguay, from Brazil, and it was really nice to feel that support. Winning here would be my dream. It would push me to become a professional gamer, and that was always my dream, even from when I was little and I started to play video games. I'm the living proof that anyone can be here. Vamos, Argentina, carajo!
Great video with Snail there, wonderful insight. As I said, he is painting himself a little bit as the underdog here, but despite that, he has the support of, it sounds like, all of South America and Latin America on his back. So he has some people's dreams riding on him here, and as he said, he's taking this tournament very seriously. He sees it as his opportunity to really make the big break, to get his name out there and potentially push himself up to being a professional Hearthstone player.
Yeah, it's a little bit of a shame that he can't stream. It would be cool to see him do his thing, but what a great story it would be if he made it far in this tournament. Right. Just like he said it himself, that he's kind of like the living proof that anybody can make it if you play well, and you don't have to be very well known or like be a legend every season or anything like that.
Yeah, that's the great thing about the the championship series this year with Blizzard events. It's just we see so many new faces, and I'm excited to see how they perform in a tournament setting.
Okay, yep. So Chess Dude, as we mentioned, very, very attached to his rogue, so no surprise to see him re-queue it here, and it's going to come up against what appears to be the Tempo Mage from Snail. Reynad, are you a fan of Tempo Mage at all?
I am, yeah. One of my favorite decks in Hearthstone, actually, to play. The thing about Rogue is it's definitely one of those classes where the players that are fans of it are kind of real fanatics, right? They'll play it for over half their games in Hearthstone. And when it comes to this matchup specifically, though, like Tempo Mage versus Rogue, in my opinion, Tempo Mage is pretty heavily favored. Cards like Flame Cannon are, incredibly effective against Rogue, dealing with really high-cost threats very effectively. We see Water Elemental here from Snail and Piloted Shredder, two 4-drops that are very effective against Rogue, tough to deal with.
Whoa, that's Edwin Van Cleef.
Yeah.
It might make some big things happen very fast.
Yeah, Edwin has this kind of unique ability to turn a pretty poor-looking hand into a pretty spectacular-looking hand, and that's what it's done right here.
Yeah, in a matchup where there's no Polymorphs, no Big Game Hunters, no Hex, anything like that available, it's just you can just go all in with it and make it a 10-10, make it a 12-12, and sometimes it wins games on its own.
Yeah, the Scientist does put a little bit of crimp in the works, though, because Chess Dude will be looking at it thinking, if a Mirror Entity comes out of that, then that's going to give me some difficulty with making this huge Edwin. And of course, we do see now the Mirror Entity in hand from Snail as well, so the Mirror Entity will probably end up in play sometime soon.
I think now would be a fine time for it.
Yeah, Snail has the option to play Mana Worm and maybe even throw out a Frostbolt if he wants to be really aggressive here, but I think Mirror Entity is just a better use of mana, really, and there's no other turn you're going to get to play that card unless you play it now.
Yeah, I mean, it brings a little bit of issue there if he's only running Mirror Entities and he's running two of those. But I would imagine that there is either like two Mirror Entities, one Counterspell, or one of each and not two Mirror Entities only.
Yeah, the obvious concern here is that the Mad Scientist potentially dies without the Death Rattle getting value, but as long as you're playing another type of secret, there's no danger of that. And again, the threat of the secret here just gives Chess Dude just a horrible decision to make. He can dissect the possible secrets here quite quickly, because as soon as, say, he tries to cast Backstab or the coin on the road to setting up his Big Edwin, he'll get the news that it's not Counterspell. When the Scientist dies, he'll get the news that at least the first secret was not Duplicate or Effigy. So he's going to be able to narrow down pretty quickly that possibly two secrets that are in play here is going to be Mirror Entity.
Yep.
It's a very tough turn for Chess Dude to play. He knows that if he does end up playing Coin and he finds out that it's not Counterspell, he finds out that it is Mirror Entity, what do you do after that? All of your plays become kind of awkward. So then he has to consider, okay, would I actually play Preparation plus Sprint? Would I just hold off? What's the way to go? So Chess Dude right now not just has to account for, what do I do if it's Counterspell, but what do I do if it's not?
Yeah, it's so difficult. Rogue quite often struggles with dealing with Mirror Entity when it's played early. There's so few minions in the Rogue deck. Oh no!
I mean, it's halfway. It's halfway. He hasn't gone all in here. So the 6-6 is coming down, and he can still take it out here using the preparation, get the board clear. So this is actually a really strong play. Reynard, you said, what is the play this turn? He's dissected this extremely well and found a way to get his 6-6 Van Cleef into play against an empty board.
I like this play a lot coming out from Chesty. This really shows his experience, honestly. He had to do in that order, right?
Yeah. I believe so. I mean, it feels so bad giving your opponent the 6-6, and
yeah,
he wasted so much of his resources. It's like he's all in with this play now.
He may be wasting his resources, but not his energy. Chesty decided to take a nap in the middle of the match. but he knows the Temple Mage is just going to run out of 4-drop most of the time here. That or have the Fireball, right? Luckily for him, no Fireball here, no clean answer for this Edwin. But even if the Mage had the Fireball in this case, you'd get a follow-up with Violet Teacher. So regardless, you know, Chesty knows this puts him in a reasonable position.
Yeah, and he can play this Violet Teacher with reasonable confidence. You know, the Mirror Entity was propped before that second Scientist was summoned, but because he saw that Snail was willing to play the one secret with the Scientist in play, he can assume that the other secrets in the deck are not Mirror Entity.
Right, and here the Violet Teacher comes down, and like you said, it's not a Mirror Entity. 5 mana available. I guess even you down to 21 already, you gotta start removing some of this stuff with maybe a Frostbolt and the Arcane Missiles, or at least one of those.
Yeah, I'm very impressed with Chesty's play so far. There were so many opportunities to make, like, a very... I don't want to use the word misplay, but like a suboptimal play, basically. Mm-hmm. And he's navigated this game perfectly, even down to last turn where he could really only justify playing the Teacher, but he could have attacked the Shredder to preserve the Teacher, maybe, but he opted to go phase two.
Right.
That's another sign of a very experienced Rogue player. He wants that, like, he respects the value of phase damage and ending the game quickly when he has a lead.
Right, it's interesting, like, the distinction between, like, a misplay, like, a regular play and an optimal play is a really important one, because when you talk about optimal plays, they are the really, like, top level of players understanding the decks, because if you break down, like, entire Hearthstone series with, say, 5 or 10 genuine top players, you'll discover that, like, maybe 1 or 2 series have ever been played perfectly in the history of Hearthstone, right? So when you say optimal, it's a really big deal.
And look at this. He even has the presence of mind here to consider running out prep for no value just to play around Counterspell. Mm-hmm. So right there, what he was thinking about is he was weighing the value of the preparation versus the value of the backstab and you know, dealing with that Mana Worm right away.
Yep. Loaded from the top. That's a pretty good god to have access to against the Rogue. Not sure if this is going to be the turn for it, but somewhere down the road, definitely will find its place.
Yeah, it's not a card we often see in Tempo Mage, but it's definitely very strong. It is a very tempo-oriented card, right? If you have the board lead, Lothab becomes absurdly powerful. It's a very strong pickup here for Snail, and it's definitely going to get paid off for including it in his decklist in this matchup.
Yep, few options here. The Mad Bomber trade for the 6-3 is kind of the most obvious one, but what else do you do? Do you just Lothab now? Is there any reason to just go for it here?
Yeah, I'm curious. I don't hate the Lothab here, but he could also just try and trade off the 6-3 and go Arcane Missiles and try and use the Water Elemental instead, potentially. This is, again, kind of situation where mana efficiency isn't necessarily correct because the Lothab actually has utility later. But the Lothab here on an empty board seems fine. Like you said, free tempo for one turn.
That is the perfect card for Chesty here.
That's a really lucky draw. Let's make use of all 6 of his mana. Deal with that Lothab even by setting it up to trade. And
Waker.
Really important pickup.
Now, Flame Waker is a great card, but he just used his Arcane Missile, so he won't be finding that much value from it.
Right. Looks like Water Elemental is just going to be developed here, and then that's a nice 8 mana combination of cards left in his hand going into turn 8 next turn.
Yeah, spells and Flame Wakers, that's the dream with Tempo Mage. That's all you
certainly
need.
Certainly is. Here we go, Preparation Sprint. Additional 4 cards going to get picked up by Chesty. Let's see what he finds. Does he find an Eviscerate, for example? That would be a great one.
Fan of Knives picked up.
I have to say, that's not at all what he was looking for in this situation. Those oils. Yeah, I mean, it's a lot of damage, but you want to do something more here.
Right. I mean, he drew the backstab at the start of the turn, which is enough with the dagger up here to get some removal options done, but... Yeah, the double Tinker's draw at this stage, not exactly what he's looking for.
And he's going to draw another card with Fan of Knives, but no longer has mana to play whatever it is. It's going to be a Blood Mage.
This Rogue deck looks kind of similar to Amnesiacs, actually. 2 oils, Sludge Belcher.
That's
true. I wonder if they may be prepared together or are influenced by like the same rank play player.
Yeah,
it's possible.
Double Tinker's Oil was pretty much core when Oil Rogue first appeared, but as time's gone on, it's moved more and more towards the single copy, so interesting to see so many players favoring the double oil here.
Snail's got the option to develop this Azure Drake, see what he gets from there, or just go with the double Flame Waker on Stable Portal, and it's definitely a tough call, right? You always are tempted to hold on to Flame Waker just a little bit longer in the late game because right. Maybe you pick up another spell.
Sure.
It seems so efficient, though. You can use all 8 of your mana, you get 4 missiles from the Unstable Portal. It's kind of like getting those at 3-4.
Flamewaker has 4 health too. It's very important against cards like Deadly Poison.
It's hard to remove, but he decides to go for the.
So some people might be wondering why Snail would make this play when he has Flamewakers in hand. And the reasoning is the minion that you get out of Unstable Portal, you know, might be a more expensive one. By playing Unstable Portal first there, he says, okay, if I get a cheap minion, I can still play Azurdrake, but if I get an expensive one, I can play it right now.
Yeah.
So he misses out on the Flame Waker value that's guaranteed, but he potentially set himself up for a better outcome.
Yeah, there's upsides and downsides in to doing it in that order. Like, it would be so nice to have that, but he would not have the mana to play all of it anyway. Because for one Flame Waker and the Fireball, let's see where the missiles go.
Okay, that's fine. One hitting it, he can still ping it off. Just means he doesn't get to develop the Mad Scientist this turn, which, you know, at the moment, while his hand is low on resources, he's unable to kind of fill his mana each turn anyway. It's not the end of the world not being able to develop that extra 2/2.
Yeah, and to be fair, the odds were against him. He needed to get that 1 in 4 to be able to eliminate the slime.
Yeah, the Scientist is also very unlikely to get value at this point. We see most Temple Mage lists only play 2 secrets. We've already seen a Mirror Entity and a Counterspell come out.
It's very true. Would pretty much just be a 2/2 at this point, but right now he'd take all the pressure he can get on the board. Rogue only at 15 health, so if he can start to develop a board of a reasonable amount of pressure, he'll be able to clutch this out with maybe something even as simple as a Frostbolt off the top. Looks like he's chest dude here is going to play the Blood Mage, recognizing he needs some board presence. Oil on top of it, take out the Flame Waker, and the Blood Mage is pretty much there just to cycle a card on the following turn, not much more than that.
Yeah, the Rogue deck in this position is kind of just treading water. You know, he had a great start, but at this stage of the game, we're really seeing why Temple Mage is so favored. Even if Rogue gets that great start, Temple Mage has the tools to get rid of Rogue's minions once it's behind. And then, you know, the Rogue deck's just kind of left with a bunch of weapons, removal. Unless you chain Sprint into the right combination of cards, it's pretty easy to fall behind.
So do you think it's time to go, Savitz? Flame Waker, Frostbolt the face?
Absolutely. I don't think there's any point in holding back at this stage. Just play your entire hand. Go for the Frostbolt on face. If the Flame Waker doesn't hit the Blood Mage, it doesn't matter. You can just Fire Blast it anyway.
Yeah, puts on so much pressure to the Rogue, makes that newly oiled dagger completely useless unless a Flurry is drawn, and just threatens so much damage on the follow-up, threatening lethal quite comfortably. So. Snail is playing at this slow, considered pace that we've been talking about, possibly due to his nerves, but maybe this is his way of dealing with the nerves and making sure he's getting things right. And honestly, it's hard to criticize too much of his play so far, so maybe it's working.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's been playing great so far.
He's opting to make kind of the conservative play here. A little bit worried about that flurry.
I think you got to play it, because one of the flurries was already played, right, on the early turn with the Edwin.
That's true.
So there's only one remaining, and holding onto the Scientist, how much value is there? So, lethal, I would have liked to see that, but I don't hate this too much.
If you get flurried, there is the extra 2-mana vanilla 2/2 in your hand really going to help you climb back onto the board. So, yeah, I would have liked to come out there, but he holds it back. I'm sure he's a little bit scared of the options in his opponent's hands. He's seen a sprint, so he knows a lot of options have come into hand recently that he doesn't have too much information on. So, sight unseen, he just decides to hold back a little bit of pressure.
Yep, one fireball remaining left for Snail, if I remember correctly.
Yep.
So, he's looking to pick that up. Oh!
Hey, that guy's good.
Hello.
I've heard about this minion.
Is it any good?
it reminds me a lot of War Golem, Savitz. I'm on the fence.
Yeah, but Dr. Boom comes down. There's a very real possibility that the Boombots will just end up being lethal here. So Chess Dude is going to have to find some creative way of dealing with this. Lotheb is not what you want here. You discussed earlier, Lotheb, how powerful it is for tempo when you're ahead. In this situation, it doesn't really do a great deal. Any Frostbolt or Fireball that's drawn off the top from Snail on the following turn will be playable anyway, so.
Aims to oil up his minions. If this oil lands on one of the freshly spawned 1/1s, I believe that's just going to be game right there because of that Doctor Boom.
There's only one way to clear.
We're good.
We got it.
Yep.
Okay. So technically not dead just yet.
Yeah, he does have to cash in basically his entire board into this 7-7. Does get to play a Lotheb on top of it, but there is a 9-1 dagger right now that is not doing a great deal.
Yeah, we saw Snail opt to ping an apprentice last turn rather than develop a minion. He knows that he wants to maximize the odds of Boombots being lethal, but also that he's going to have the mana to play these minions next turn anyway.
Right.
Opts not to ping a minion first.
Oh, yeah,
that's immediately punished.
So if you're straight going for lethal there, it is optimal to ping one of the 1-1s first to maximize your chance for lethal. Obviously, the ping gives you the flexibility of being able to ping face at the end, but odds-wise, it's dramatically better if you ping off one of the minions first. So second one does go face, puts the rogue down to 3, so we are very, very close to lethal. And I imagine the ping to face is just going to come down every turn here. Yeah. Wow. Oh,
okay.
No. Oh, no.
Well, that's surprising.
Snail knows that Chessdude has no cards in his hand, and he's playing around the chance that Chessdude draws Blade Flurry.
Mm-hmm.
Because he knows that this scientist alone is lethal anyway.
One Blade Flurry in the deck, and he's playing around his opponent top decking it. A little bit surprising. I feel like this might be a mistake because he's giving Chessdude some extra time.
This might be the nerves that the Snail mentioned coming into play a little bit. He wants to make the more conservative play. He has this nightmare scenario mapped out in his head where, you know, Blade Flurry comes off the top and blows up my board and there's Lotheb. But honestly, this play might be correct if we really think of it. I mean, I'm not going to say it's 100% wrong. Imagine he plays every minion in his hand and it gets flurried.
I mean, okay, I can get on board with holding stuff back. What I can't get on board with is not pinging him in the face. He's on three health right now.
Yeah.
Like, you know, sure, hold back some resources to play against removal, but he's on a clock right now. Increase that clock every turn. Just ping him in the face and get the job done.
I would love to also, like, see at least 2 out of 3 of the minions. Maybe save the Flame Waker if you get a spell, but
yeah,
as it is, there's 14 power from Chessdude, so if he chooses to play his entire hand right now, something like an Eviscerate from the top, it would just win Chessdude the game, so now it's a little bit too late.
Yeah, I think Snail has to recognize that it's time to go all in at this point.
Nope.
And hold off on the Flame Waker.
This is good enough for me, I'm not
going
to criticize this. Let's see what it is. He needs an Eviscerate.
That looked very much like Eviscerate to me. It was, oh my god, the punish.
Yeah, Snail paying the ultimate price in this particular game. Chessdude finds the Eviscerate for exact lethal.
Wow.
What a heartbreak from Snail.
Very rare that you see an Eviscerate for exactly 2 damage. An uncomboed Eviscerate just winning the game, but honestly, we can paint that any way we want it, but Snail gave that game up. He could have loaded up the game before. You know, he could have had the ping to face. Obviously, the ping to face wouldn't have changed anything. The game would have still ended while the rogue was on 1 instead of 2 in that case. But
I think if you go for the just scientist plus nothing play that he did go for, I think pinging the Lotheb is correct, because then if anything but sap is drawn, he has to trade the Lotheb in, right? So
sure.
He wants to be able to finish off Lotheb and then develop stuff. But yeah, I'm fairly convinced that, you know, not developing all of your minions or most of them was probably not the optimal line of play there.
Yeah, like, but in general, playing around cards when your opponent has no cards in hand is a little bit questionable strategy.
Yeah, I mean, they're on their 1 out to make the draw, but yeah, Snail made some questionable plays, but Chessdude, we were very impressed with his rogue play overall throughout both games, even the one he lost. We had an opportunity to talk to Chessdude a little bit earlier about what it's like being a Hearthstone and a chess prodigy.
Hi, my name's Chris Gu. My battle tag is ChessDude123. I'm 17 and I'm from Rhode Island. South Kingstown is pretty chill. Kind of matches my personality. Yeah, I've been playing chess since I was 5, and I became a chess master when I was 12. That already put me in the top 1% of chess players in the world. You know, I would have days where I just, you know, wake up, play chess 10 hours straight. I would really enjoy doing that, you know. I've played in over 100 tournaments in my life. I've been constantly ranked in the top 5 in my age group. Probably my biggest accomplishment in chess was winning the 2014 National High School Championship. I was able to also win a full scholarship to the University of Texas, Dallas. One of the biggest things I like about chess is there's always so many decisions to make, and I really like being able to try to navigate my way through the position and kind of out-strategize my opponents. I think that definitely translates to Hearthstone. Yeah, it was definitely hard to convince my parents about Hearthstone. They did not really approve of you know, playing a video game.
We keep reminding him that, you know, this is only a passion. This is something that we don't know for sure. This is your career.
You know, after I did well in the preliminaries, I guess I was able to show that, you know, I have the ability to play well and go far in tournaments. A win this weekend would be amazing, but I guess to them, it would still be a video game.
If he wins this championship, and we'll do a lot of celebrate, but then go back to school.
Winning the winter championships this weekend would definitely be the biggest accomplishment of my life so far.
Fascinating stuff overall there from Chess Dude, but what I found most interesting there is the little tug of war he has with his dad there, or Chess Dad, I guess we call him.
Chess Dad.
Just about, you know, this is a struggle that a lot of people will have gone through, from, you know, parents, grandparents, members of an older generation of, you know, is what they're doing legitimate? You know, there's this perception they're playing video games, they're wasting their time. You know, people of our kind of generation, we accept all of this and what we're doing as an established thing, but being able to get your parents' approval for playing video games and wasting so much time is very difficult, and that's obviously a struggle that Chess Dude is encountering as well.
Yeah, I actually got a chance to talk to his dad a lot over dinner a couple nights ago, and it just really opens your eyes to, like, the perspective of, you know, parents in this new esports space, like,
right.
You know, their take on it, kind of the uncertainty about career paths, and yeah, it's just a really cool to see Chess Dude give it a go in something he's passionate about, and his dad supporting it.
I'm sure if Chess Dad spent time talking to you right now that he's now all on board for this esports thing. He feels suitably reassured.
I'm a realist.
Yeah.
Sottle,
yeah, okay. And so, yeah, looking at the remaining lineups, we have the Paladin and the Mage from Snail up against the Mage and the Druid from Chess Dude. Any of these matchups stick out to either of you?
Yeah, I have to say that since Chess Dude had that rogue in his lineup, I would predict his mage to be freeze mage in this particular instance, because the decks tend to go in pairs. They have the same matchups, you can have the same ban that would affect both decks, and I was just about to say that if the mage decks get matched up against each other, that mirror entity in Snail's tempo mage might end up working against him because of the Doomsayer.
Yeah, if you have experience in this matchup and you have mirror entity in your deck, you pretty much never play mirror entity in hand. You even consider whether you play Mad Scientist because of the threat of Doomsayer on the mirror entity.
What a hand from Snail, yeah. Though. Bad matchup, but that hand, it's perfect. He has the early curve and the Lota, which is the best late game card in this matchup.
So this is the beauty of Tempo Mage, is that even if your matchup is objectively bad, anytime you have Mana Worm plus a coin in your opening hand, it all of a sudden becomes at least slightly favored, in my opinion.
Yeah.
It makes almost any combination of cards you have into a very smooth curve,
right.
Puts on a lot of early pressure, really lets you take advantage of just the natural progression of the deck.
Yeah, I think there's two decks in Hearthstone that you can say that for. One is Tempo Mage and the Mana Worm, and the other one is Aggro Shaman and the Tunnel Troll.
Yep.
Very, very similar thing. It just instantly makes your hand if you have that opening.
Heads up play there going phase two.
So strong here. It picks up a Dune Moss Shaman. We don't see that card very often. It does have that overload to it, so If you wanted to play it on turn 4, that would make the Lotep unavailable for 5.
It's pretty great on turn 6 with a Lotep, though.
Yeah? I can get behind that.
I wouldn't be surprised just to see it played out here, though. He can then curve that into either Flamewake or Arcane Intellect on the following turn. So it seems perfectly reasonable. Get the overload out of the way here. Seems like the curve develops pretty nicely from this point. Ice Barrier is activated. Nice for the Freeze Mage to get the Ice Barriers active as early as possible before the threat of just plain burst damage from hand that can ignore the melee activation of the Ice Barrier comes into play.
Yep, instant fireball from Chess Dude. Sees that Dune Maul Shaman, what was it?
That's it.
Threatening him for 10 damage next turn, and that's just, he doesn't want any piece of that.
Chess Dude's gonna avoid the mauling, though, has the burn spell to take it off the board. And yeah, Snail's just gonna develop a 3-drop because of that overload. So the thing about Lotheb is, again, in the Freeze Mage matchup, it's always a little bit difficult to know, like, should I play it on curve?
Right.
Should I hold on to it and try to play it, like, after I pop Ice Block? And it really depends on the texture of your hand in a lot of cases, in my opinion. What are your thoughts on that, Savitz? When's the right time to play Lotheb?
The right time to play Lotheb? Well, I really like playing it fairly fast. When you have enough stuff on your board, so basically, if you have a board worth protecting, then it's a good time to play the low tap. If you have barely nothing or just like a easily mana worm, then probably no. Just play some other stuff. Also, there's some like key windows for it. Like you want to play the low tap before turn 8, because on turn 8 your opponent will be able to cast the Frost Nova anyway. Another good turn to play it would be when your opponent is about to hit 7 mana to play around the Flame Strike. Now a potential issue with that is that then they can play drop an Emperor Torison, but just protecting your board from the Flame Strike, it's pretty good.
In particular, you can use it as a reaction to telegraphs that you get from the mage player. You know, they might use a Blizzard for seemingly very little value, but it suddenly gets everything into Flame Strike range. Or they ping a specific minion when you have 3 or 4 minions on board that makes you think, okay, it's Flame Strike next turn. And then you can just shut that whole thing down with a Lothar.
Yeah. Snail hesitates a little bit here on playing Azuradrake because, you know, it never feels great to allow your opponent to just kill your Mana Worm for free with that heal bot. But also with Hero Power, Chess Dude has the option of killing Flame Waker instead. He's basically setting up for a Shredder plus Hero Power next turn to finish off Antique Healbot regardless.
Yep, could be it. Very important to ping that here, saving the Blood Mage. It's fine to cycle the Blood Mage against the Tempo Mage, but not in this situation when you don't have the mana to do it. Counterspell, that might work wonders.
Yeah, if he was going to draw one of his secrets, that's probably the one that he wants to draw. Does not want to have Mirror Entity in hand. There are points you can use it. You know, if you don't have a massive board lead, you can play it to protect yourself from an Archmage Antonidas or an Alexstrasza, at least get some sort of value out of it that way. But most of the time, it's a detriment to the player that's going to have the biggest board in this matchup because of the threat of Doomsayer.
So, yeah. Even though Chess Dude has very few cards to really play in his hand right now, and he was tempted to play that Blood Mage last turn, he opted to ping instead because it left him with 2-1 health minions. So now Snail can't ping both of them off, and now he's going to get value out of his Loot Hoarder. Now he's able to deal with one of the 3 health minions of Snails because of that line of play. Yeah. So kind of thinking 2 turns ahead there, really paying off.
Snail showing no fear there. If his opponent had a Flame Strike, might have been better to clear at least some of those minions. And it would have been maybe kind of destroyed, but missing out on that damage would have been so big. And now it's going to be Chess Dude making those trades.
Yeah, okay, he's like going to come down here. You saw him choose to trade off his Scientist before trading off the Loot Hoarder. Make sure that the secret gets pulled first before he draws the card, because he doesn't want to pull that into hand. I believe Ice Block is active in the hand right now, so that's Barrier that we have equipped.
Yep.
And so, yeah, considering the Arcane Intellect right now, but also interesting that he didn't play the Ice Block beforehand to force the Barrier, because there is, I believe, 1 block, 1 barrier left in his deck, at least before the Scientist pulled it.
Well, that's true.
That's a good point.
You do kind of want to see what you draw, I suppose, before making your play. So it might be one of those muscle memory type of reactions. Draw before doing stuff.
Yeah, there are general rules in Hearthstone that are always right until they aren't, right? Yeah. Like, yeah, always draw first. Yeah, except for when that's not true.
So if at any point, starting now, Snail does opt to play Lotheb, Chess Dude is going to have potential Frost Nova available to him.
To counter it. But there is the counterspell. So that could have maybe protected from that expensive spell. It would have been an option to save the counterspell for now and try to go for the low tap and counterspell on the same turn.
Huh,
it does play it here though.
Yeah, he did have the option to go with maybe an Apprentice plus Unstable Portal there. But Snail's aware of the possibility of cards like Flame Strike, Blood Mage Blizzard.
Yep, right. The Blood Mage Blizzard would have been so good, but that counterspell is going to keep him safe from it.
Yeah, I mean, he might end up trying to go for it here. He might just play the Blood Mage, see if it ends up being Mirror Entity, and if it is, he gets a perfect clear on the Mirror Entity minion as well. But maybe there's kind of a double bluff thing here where a Chess Dude will perhaps respect Snail enough to say, well, he wouldn't play Mirror Entity here. So, like, he's not going to play Mirror Entity in this matchup at all, so he'll probably just assume this is Counterspell based on what he saw on the previous game.
It's definitely true. We might also see just maybe an Ice Lance to test for it, and then an Emperor Thorsen. There's a lot of options available to Chess Dude here. So he's aware that it is most likely Counterspell. He's going to develop 2 minions.
Yep, good play there, playing that Emperor instead. But now this is the time for Lotus. It has to be, right? Because even if there is that Frost Nova, the Counterspell is still going to stop it. There's pretty much nothing that can go wrong, right?
Yeah, I mean, it seems unlikely that there's a clean answer to it. It's just a matter of, is this enough pressure to end the game? Because Lotheb is also one of your big game enders for after you pop the first ice block. So if you're sacrificing that earlier in the game, you need to be sure that the board that you're protecting is enough that it's going to carry you to victory.
Right.
That's the question. Is what he has here enough?
Because there could be an Alexstrasza in Chess Dude's hand too, but yeah. I think that if there's an Alexstrasza, he's going to lose the game regardless.
Sure.
I guess I have the luxury to see the hands and kind of see that the loaded would be pretty nice because there's only spells right now for Chess Dude. But I think even without seeing it, it's just it's pretty tempting. You kind of just go all in with the loaded and hope for the best.
It's interesting, he is leaving the Blood Mage up and he is playing the Lotheb, so down to 18. Representing 15 damage on board, plus the spells in hand that can buff up the Mana Worm. So yeah, he is definitely threatening to pop the first block here. So I'm on board with this Lotheb play. It looks like he has enough pressure here to push through and win the game. So
yeah, it worked out exceptionally well. Chessu does not have the Nova here to really just reduce 15 damage from his opponent. So he does have a Blood Mage draw.
Which
still
again, the counter spell is still in play though, right?
Right. So regardless, it's there's no way to fit the two spells in.
Right.
See, does he find an Alexstrasza or something?
Oh. There it is. There's that 8-mana Frost Nova.
And he is convinced it's counterspell already because he tested with minions.
Yeah, and he has information from the previous games as well as to what secrets there were. He saw one mirror entity, so he knows it's not that. So highly suspicious that it's the counterspell here.
This was kind of the advantage of testing with Ice Lance rather than Blood Mage, is that you would be able to respond to a Lotheb with a Frost Nova.
Right.
But on top of that, you would also be able to... Sorry, completely losing my train of thought. In case you draw Doomsayer, you would be able to still take advantage of a mirror entity if that's the secret that Hedy played, right?
Yeah.
So, but yeah, Counterspell is going to be pretty effective, so is Lotheb, and Chessy's going to get dropped pretty low here.
So he doesn't quite have it here. That's going to be a 5-attack Mana Worm by the time it's done, from what we can see. Frostbolt helps. Yep, that'll
do it.
Yeah, that will get it done.
I'm just going to let him pop the first block.
Ooh,
is it?
Yeah.
Frostbolt, then attack, then
it buffs
ping.
It, yep.
Yep.
Absolutely.
So now the question is, do you even play the Mad Scientist?
You probably portal. After the Mana Worm here is completely correct. He wanted that Mana Worm to attack for 5, not 6. But yeah, start with portal here, just get the mana spent, see what you get. Hey! What's up, buddy? Murloc Tiny Finn.
Doomsayer, a little bit late to the party.
Some of the best artwork in Hearthstone there.
Yeah, just leave that there for the rest of the tournament now. Just that draw should never slide back in. We can just hang out with Murloc Tiny Finn.
Snail walking a mile in Raynad's shoes.
Yeah.
Except he's winning games.
All right, so we had some criticisms about Snail's play in the previous game.
Right.
But I think we also at great length discussed how intricate and how important the decision about whether to play that Lotheb or not was. He got it absolutely right. He had exactly the amount of pressure that he needed. He also recognized the situation with the Mana Worm at the end there, needing to attack for 5, not for 6, sequencing correctly with the unstable portal. So maybe we can put the previous series, this previous game down just to nerves. He's tightened things up a little bit more now, and he's back looking in a decent spot in this series.
Yeah, we talked about the timing of Lotheb being so important. I think he did perfect. That was exactly when he was supposed to play it. He played it at the right time, and he ended up winning the game. That was very well played by Snail.
Yeah, absolutely.
Cool tech choice to begin with, right? It's not a card we normally see in Tempo Mage.
That's very true.
It's really paying off for him.
Yeah, Lotheb not in all the time, but with the amount of Rogue, possibly Freeze Mage you'd expect in a tournament like this, then it's a decent inclusion. And he is just down now to the Paladin, left to win with. We've seen the situations where Paladin feels like a deck that you should feel confident you're going to win 1 out of 2 with, but we've seen it as a deck, not just in this tournament, but in previous tournaments, be a deck get reverse swept out of series.
It'll be interesting to see what type of Paladin it is. You know, kind of expected, at least I expected before the tournament, that most Paladins would be Secret Paladin.
Right.
But, you know, today we've seen Murlocs, anything. It's could be anything, really. Control Paladins, something I've started to see in ranked play nowadays. Now it looks like it is going to be the traditional secret list.
Yep, so far it looks a fairly standard secret Paladin. Definitely not Murlocs. We don't know exactly what he is running for late game. Is he running cards like Divine Favor? That is absolutely huge in this matchup, because the Freeze Mage will always throw a lot of cards. So if he's playing those Divine Favors, it would really help out.
Yeah, there's a bunch of tech choices in Secret Paladin that can improve what is a pretty unfavorable matchup to a relatively even, maybe even slightly favored one. Things like Iron Beak Owl that can deal with Doomsayer situations incredibly favorably. Whether you're playing Lotheb, which most are, but sometimes it gets dropped in favor of, say, Sludge Belcher. And then, as you said, the Divine Favor as well. This is one of the matchups where Divine Favor really, really shines as a Secret Paladin player.
Any thoughts on keeping the Goghammer?
It's I feel like the reason that Snail values Coghammer highly in this matchup is because it is, like, it's not a minion, but it's still pressure, right? It's very hard for Chesty to interact with it. It's a guaranteed way to just get closer to proccing Ice Block. 6 damage on one card, straight to the face.
Yeah,
that'll do.
I mean, Coghammer is no Doomhammer, but it's the same concept, right? Like, you want to have this thing that Freeze Mage can't interact with. Their entire deck is built to prevent pressure coming from on the board, but if you can just equip a weapon that does a ton of damage, then that helps you push through a bunch of pressure. So like you said, 6 damage for 3 mana, pretty efficient ratio, gets the job done.
Yeah, it got me a little bit by surprise, because he did not have a 1-drop or a 2-drop in his hand, and for turn 3, Master for Battle is quite often still the better play, even if you have that.
It's cool to see. Oh, sorry, True Silver Champion being played here as well. It's kind of an uncommon card in Secret Paladin, and the reason that matters in this matchup is because, along with Keeper of Uldumon, it gives you an answer for Doomsayer.
Right. Yeah, but I was just going to say, I wasn't too fond of trading into the Mad Scientist there, knowing that this is Freeze Mage. Generally, killing the Freeze Mage's Mad Scientists for them is generally a bad idea for two reasons. Firstly, you want to have the pressure on them and just be dealing the face damage and being aggressive. Secondly, you give them every chance of drawing a secret if you let that scientist stay alive for one more turn. By pulling a secret for them, you then increase the density of their potential draws on the following turn.
That's true.
Unless... Ooh, that's a great card. Oh, but...
Unless they draw all 4 of their secrets, though, they're still going to get one at some point off of that scientist. And by making that trade, he took advantage of his Divine Shield and he protected his 1/1s, which are now going to continue dealing damage throughout the game.
Sure.
Blessing of Kings, that certainly helps to put out a lot of pressure early on. And Chess Dude looking for a Frost Nova Doomsayer, but has neither in his hand right now.
He has neither piece of it. He just has kind of stalling tactics in his hand right now. Ice Barrier will buy him some time, but he's really lacking that AoE until he gets all the way up to Flame Strike. And by that point, the pressure on the board might just be too immense.
Absolutely. Yep. He's got a lot of weapon charges in hand, too. And the game is, most of the time, doesn't last too far past about 11. So you want to make sure you have time to use all of your weapon charges. But yeah, here in this case, I would definitely not like to see a weapon. I'd prefer a Belcher or a Blessing.
Yeah, I would just go for the Kings, because it's such a desperate matchup, and trying to end it as early as possible is one of the keys to success, in my opinion. But I don't hate the Belcher either. It's more mana efficient, and it does have that Death Rattle. Also, the Blessing of Kings will still be quite efficient later on. All you need for the Blessing of Kings to be good is one minion that's not frozen.
And he's also considering it's turn 5 coming up, right? Potential Doomsayer Frost Nova play,
right.
So maybe save the Blessing for after that, use it on a slime.
Yep, gets a Sticky Death Rattle minion on board that can survive the Doomsayer play, whereas the Kings would just be another huge investment that could get swept out by it, so makes a lot of sense to me. He doesn't quite have enough mana next turn to follow up with the, you know, Keeper of Alderman on the Doomsayer and have enough mana left over to be able to answer it, so... Yeah, he is a little bit exposed to it still here, so I like the Belcher play.
It's unfortunate in this case for Chesty that he doesn't have either Frost Nova or Doomsayer, so playing Arcane Intellect isn't that appealing because you can't really draw the piece of the combo that you're missing. And that Frost Nova Doomsayer combo, we haven't really talked about it too much, but that's really the swing combo that turns the matchup in favor of Freeze Mage, if they can get it off.
It really is. The anti-heal was not looking too bad here. He does get the full effect from it. Looks like he might be leaning towards that. Definitely saving the coin here to potentially have the access to the turn 6 Flame Strike.
Yeah, and it's really important here that Snail recognizes that Chess Dude is yet to coin and realizes that Flame Strike can come down next turn. And he can use this Blessing of Kings to get 2 minions up to 5 health here, trade off the other things that are more exposed to Flame Strike, and just make the Flame Strike incredibly punishing for Chess Dude if he wants to cast it.
Yeah, something like Kings on the Keeper of Uldumon, that would be quite powerful. There's always that risk that there's first going to be like Blizzard getting played, or that Doomsayer Nova, but I don't think you can really hold back here just playing around the Doomsayer Nova. So it's pretty safe to say that if there was a Doomsayer Nova, it would have been played there, because there was already 13 power on the board.
Absolutely.
Yeah, playing a Healbot there, just straight back into 13, going back into your face, just seems so suboptimal that you can pretty much rule out, maybe even as far as Coin Blizzard, you can rule out. So Coin Flame Strike has to be on your radar here as something that's coming up. So I would have loved to see Maximum Pressure come down here with the Blessing of Kings. He's going to load up the Coghammer instead, which does do a similar thing in terms of increasing the stickiness of another one of his minions. Just doesn't quite push through as much pressure.
Yep, Snail's going to trade in one of his minions, just set up that Healbot to die to Noble Sacrifice, but that does telegraph his secret.
Yep.
Chess dude's fairly confident he doesn't have to play around Redemption or anything like that right now.
Ice Barrier. It's usually not a bad card in this matchup. It allows you to buy some extra time, but he really needs to start removing these minions. And Ice Barrier is not going to help with that particular issue.
It is not, no. And that shield going onto the minibot has made the Flame Strike awkward. Even if he does choose to Flame Strike here, there's still just a ton of damage left on the board coming back through next turn. And if you take Flame Strike out of this hand, like, what does he have left in terms of fighting back? So he really needs to make that Flame Strike work for him in the long term. So may just come down to a stalling play this turn. But like you said, Ice Barrier not helping him towards any sort of win condition here.
Yeah, Chess Dude needs that Arcane Intellect to be very, very good. Still looking for
Nova.
Looking for Nova Doomsayer. If he just gets the Nova alone, it does buy him a lot of time. It's still a great card to pick up, but it's not going to deal with his board.
Looks like he is going to attack with that heal, but just in case that it would be something else than Noble Sacrifice, although it was really clearly, like you said, Reyna, it was like given away by the attack with that 1-1. He's just going to do the Flamestruck anyway. Two minions are going to survive. The Belcher is going to be a 3-1, still with the Death Rattle. And boom from the top. Well, that might change things a little.
Well, Snail is going to take his time. He's going to consider all his options this turn. And he's going to evaluate the relative merits. I mean, Blessing of Kings is not ridiculous here. It pushes through more damage right now, but Dr. Boom off the top seems like a significantly stronger option. Gets the job done. The Boombots themselves now just have the possibility of threatening lethal, even in the case of a board clear.
There Absolutely. We go. Anything Chestu does to deal with those Boombots on his turn is going to make him potentially die, even with Ice Block up. He has to be careful with any future Nova Doomsayers, even Blizzards, that he ends up playing on
right.
his board.
It's looking like desperate times for Chess Dude. He's going to go for the Arcane Intellect, kind of has to. Still no Frost Nova.
Yeah, looks like he's going to have to throw out an Ice Lance here just to gain 7 life.
Yeah, Ice Lance there, Dr. Boom. It's not great, but there's no other option, really.
It really isn't. It's necessary, but it's just another one of his win conditions melting away, because if he could somehow find the extra turns here with the Alexstrasza, the second Ice Block in hand, and the Fireball and the Ice Lance, there was a chance he could start to put together a play where he can just burn his opponent back. But yeah, he's in trouble here. 16 total health, 5, 6, 7, 9 in play, 13 with the Blessing of Kings, and 15? With the True Silver, yeah, adding 2 extra, overwriting the Coghammer, so he's one off being able to pop the block this turn.
That is right. So not getting pop, not gonna be able to pop that, and it's a huge deal. But he's still in such a great spot with those Boombots. The board clearing is just not really possible for Chess Dude. He would need to heal up first, but he already played his heal bot. So what options does he have? He needs to Alexstrasza himself and Nova same turn.
This is interesting. Is the Blessing of Kings not being invested this time?
I would really like to see the Kings come out. But
right.
He is going. No, he is using it. Okay.
He's just going to make a 7-7 Boombot. All
yes.
right, this is fine. Sure.
Yeah, that's pretty good.
Dr. Boom and Dr. Bot.
Dr. Bot.
I mean, this does create the world where that Boombot is harder to kill, and therefore things like Blizzard don't necessarily pop it and create the weird situation where it beats Ice Block because Ice Block doesn't activate. But there's still that second Boombot which will do the same job here, so no real harm. And this is looking grim here for Chess Dude. He does have the second Ice Block in hand, so he can navigate through this with the reliability of a certain number of guaranteed turns in this game, but I think any line he tries to examine here, he's going to get the sad news that he just doesn't have enough turns to set anything up here.
I think he just got to go for the Ember and hope for the best. I don't know what he can really do. Maybe with a Nova and something, he could survive to turn 10, and then on turn 10 play like Alexstrasza, Ice Block. It's really
right.
hard from here. But the Ember, the block is getting popped anyway, so you just play the strongest thing, I guess. And the Nidus would just die and nothing would happen, so I think it's an easy Emperor once you consider all the options.
Yeah, Chessy's considering the cards in his deck, potentially could play a Loot Hoarder, ping it himself, see what he could draw, maybe get a Nova off of that, but yeah, realistically, most straightforward play after taking his time is what he's going to go with.
There may even be merit there. I mean, you have the chance of dying, like, by pinging the Boombot after you play Emperor, because it feels pretty important to get that Boombot off the board, so cards like Blizzard, for example, are actually castable on this board without killing yourself.
Yeah, it still leaves one Boombot left over, so I don't know if that, down the line, ever gives him the opportunity to, like, survive the Boombot shot on his turn.
Right, but the remaining Boombot would be a 7-7, so, for example, Blizzard could be cast without killing a Boombot.
That's a good point.
There's the Doomsayer, but much, much too late at this point. Joined by a friend. No. There they both are.
Not like this. Just do it. Finally finds a Doomsayer. Not just one, but two of them, but it's way too late. And yeah, the Ice Block might buy him another turn, but how do you turn it this into a victory?
Yeah, I just don't see it. Archmage Antonidas, Ice Block to develop another Fireball, but then you still need to find that extra turn to Alexstrasza, your opponent, which just isn't happening. The defensive Alex isn't going to do anything because there's so much damage stacked up on the board. He's in a world of trouble.
Yep.
One thing is for sure, the two mana has to be spent on playing Ice Block this turn.
Yeah. No doubt about it. What to
do? And Snail, you know, painted himself as the underdog, but he's poised to take this series in kind of convincing fashion here. This is very impressive, to be honest.
It sure is.
He's looking for a potential Nova.
You got the Nova?
Oh, he got it.
Yep. And
well, that's good, but is it enough?
Yeah, you can't Nova Doomsayer because you just died to the Boombots.
Yeah, the Boombots would get the job done.
Right. So the problem is, like, even theoretically, if the True Silver Champion wasn't in hand to be able to pop this block again. Theoretically, you bought yourself one more turn, but you did nothing in that turn to progress yourself further towards being able to win the game.
Hey,
that's a low theb. All right.
Yeah.
So, yeah, True Silver Champion going to come down here. Pop the block. That is block number two, so none more left in the deck. He's chewed through both barriers as well. Even the board clear will pop the Boombots and spell the end of the game here. So Chess Dude is going to fairly quickly go through the routine here, but I'm pretty sure come up with the news that there is no way out, and we're going to see a concede followed by a celebration from the underdog Snail. Yeah.
It's been pretty clear. It has been fairly clear for a long time that that was Snail's game right there. If this was played online in ranked play, then maybe we would have seen a concede a few turns earlier, but there's so much on the line here. No early concedes. Maybe there was some kind of long shot, but nope, Snail takes it.
Yeah, so the underdog Snail vanquishes the chess veteran and the avid rogue player Chess Dude. Maybe that 50% total game history with rogue came back to bite him. We saw him successful with the rogue. We were very impressed with his rogue play, but then wasn't able to follow that up with his other decks.
I mean, it is a bit unfortunate for Chess Dude too. I feel like both players played well, mm-hmm. but in Chess Dude's case, he played Rogue and Freeze Mage and ran up against like four Lothebs in four games. So it's a tough matchup to get.
All right, well, can't wait to hear a bit more from Snail, and thankfully we have him standing by with Frodan. Let's find out what they have to say.
Thank you very much, Sottle and crew. I'm joined by Snail, the Tavern Hero from Argentina. What, the only Tavern Hero to make it to this tournament. Yep. Being on this stage, being able to take the win, and you were saying that you were carrying the burden of everyone in Latin America. You got messages from Uruguay, from Brazil, from everywhere. What's it like taking that first victory and getting one step closer to being the champion?
It feels really good just to get that out of the way. But it's just the first step, you know. I still have a long way.
It seemed like during those matches, it was really intense back and forth. What kept you calm to be able to continue to play your games, to make sure that you didn't really mess up at any point during the series after your first initial mistakes?
I definitely messed up in the game against Rogue. Stay calm. Yeah, that's not me. I get really nervous. I'm still working on that. So, yeah, still happy that I could win.
Now that you've taken out Chess Dude, who's statistically one of the best players here at the competition, do you feel like your confidence has soared, or do you feel like at this point you're still just evaluating and taking it one game at a time?
Well, they all are good players here. There is no better here. I still think that Chess Dude is really a nice, really good player and a nice guy also. Yeah, I was kind of sad to face him in the first round, so yeah.
A lot of people are looking at you as a representation of themselves, that anybody can do it. What message do you have for everybody who's watching, scared to enter some tournaments, but then too can also be a Tavern Hero? Do you have anything to say to them?
Well, practice hard, I guess.
and it pays off. Well, there you have it. Snail is the last person to take a victory today, getting one step closer. Well, tomorrow he'll battle out against Skyhigh to see if he can get first in the group. Congratulations. We'll send it over to the sidebar and see what they thought about the matches with Snail versus Chess Dude.
Practice hard, very wise words coming out of Snail. What a match from him coming in as one of the underdogs. I don't think people can really argue that as being one of the, or the only Tavern Hero to make it this far. And interesting lineups today. Core, I want to talk to you first a little bit about the mage choices coming in today. Chessdude had a lot of trouble taking the win with the Freeze Mage, and we've seen Temple Mage have success. And why is this? Why is the Freeze Mage struggling to find a win now?
You know, it's actually really hard to say because in the preliminaries, we saw all Freeze Mage. I believe there might have been one Tempo Mage, but it didn't pull out a win as I can remember. So I was actually very surprised to see two Tempo Mages in the tournament at all. Just sort of assumed they would all be Freeze Mage. It could be anything from lack of experience. We saw some poor draws. So, I mean, you can really chalk it up to, you know, any number of things. But I was surprised to see the Tempo Mage get a win over the Freeze Mage in one of the previous games today. So Mage struggles occasionally, especially with the amount of control warriors we've seen. That could actually be a huge problem for the Freeze Mages that were brought.
Yeah, and the predictability of Freeze Mage as well. Their win condition is very telegraphed. And Rob, I'm going to come to you next. We can bring up the screenshot that we have from the first match where the unpredictability of Tempo Mage and that you don't actually know what secrets they're going to be playing. So we have a moment here where Chess Dude is in a situation where he doesn't know what secret package this is. He has to find a way to play around it all. What do you think of the decision of Snail here to put Duplicate and Counterspell in his deck for Tempo Mage as opposed to Mirror Entity?
So Mirror Entity is generally what you're expecting when you play against a Tempo Mage. Like, that's the primary secret you're considering. Coin is great for Counterspell. Obviously, you have the option to just immediately disable it without wasting a precious spell. In terms of Duplicate, I like running Duplicate in these decks. It's a little greedier, but it can definitely do work, especially when you have those big minions like Water Elemental, which are hard to remove.
Yeah, actually, this was the play where Mirror Entity was shown. So Chess Dude had to navigate through the turn, exactly playing around both Counterspell and Mirror Entity and how he would deal with it. And, Cord, do you agree with this line of play where he used the coin for Counterspell and then was able to kill off the Edwin Van Cleef?
Yeah, I do. I think especially when you're roping, when you're under that much of a high-pressure situation, it was really great sequencing that he did go about it in the way that he did, and it ended up clearing off the board. It was, in fact, the right play. So I was very happy with that.
Yeah, and Chess Dude, of course, we had the statistics shown that he has over a 60% win rate with Rogue, and he plays over 50% of his ladder matches with it, so I was really impressed with this play. We're going to go to the same match, another clip here. We can bring up that screenshot. This is towards the end of the match, and we heard Snail say that sometimes nerves play into effect, and he was playing super passively and holding on to creatures in his hand because he was afraid that Chess Dude was going to top deck like a Blade Flurry to punish him for playing creatures. So, Rob, walk me through the sequence of this play and the options that he has with, you know, pinging a creature and then pinging the face as opposed to pinging the Lothib. So let's roll the clip, and Rob, why don't you walk us through it?
Right, so the first thing you're going to do is cash in on those Boombots, see where they go. Mm-hmm. Probably going to go ahead and just put them into the 1/1s there, kind of see what happens, try to see what you can do in terms of damaging either the face or just going straight for the Lothab. And you had the option to just drop all those creatures and just put up a united front. And I think the more controversial point was where he chose to ping, though. You know, Reyna did a great job basically highlighting the fact that if you run into a Blade Flurry off the top of the deck, you're in a really bad spot. But by pinging the face after this Boombot hits it for 3, you can very easily set it to a 2-turn game at the very least. And Snail chose ultimately to ping the Lothab, and I'm not necessarily sure I agree with that, again, because you want to put your opponent on that clock. You want to basically set them on 2 turns. He has a Flamewaker and he has the Manworm, and if you draw the spells, those are obviously more powerful, but at the end of the day, they're bodies, and that's basically what you need to close out the game there.
Yeah,
Had he played the Flamewaker, the Mad Scientist, and the Manaworm, I believe he would have actually won the next turn, as well as, you know, pinging the face. I'm sure he was waiting for a spell to combo with that Flamewaker, could have done some extra damage. That was probably the win condition he was going for. But in this case, being so afraid of the Blade Flurry actually lost him the game.
Yeah, so 2 turns later, that was when the Eviscerate was drawn to end the game.
Sure.
So he could have set up for that couple turn lethal. So hopefully he can get his nerves together. He played super well in the other matches and still ended up taking the series. So hope he can calm his nerves and let that good play shine through for the rest of his matches. But we'll have to see. But that's going to be all the matches that we have for you guys today. We are going to send it back over to the cash store today. But before we do that, let's head and look at some highlights from that last match.
Welcome back to the Tavern. I am still here, joined by Reynad and Savitz, and we have reached the end of gameplay for today. Awesome day overall. Just to recap, we have had wins for Nostam, Amnesiac, AlSkyHigh, and Snail, who I believe advanced through. None of the players are eliminated yet. They still have the chance to operate from the lower bracket. And yeah, we can see the bracket right here. Nostam picking up the win over Chucky in game one. Chucky, very much one of the favorites for this tournament. We mentioned he's multiple high-placing player in various tournaments, still looking for that big win.
Yeah, he will be facing Amnesiac in the winner bracket, who brought that Murloc Druid. Paladin, excuse me.
Right. And moving over to Group B, AlSkyHigh vanquishes WTY Bill in a matchup of Master versus Apprentice, really, Reynad. AlSkyHigh said that he's an avid viewer of WTY Bill's stream, felt kind of unconfident in being able to hang with him, thought he was outclassed, thought that Bill was the superior player. Didn't work out that way. And similar story in the second game that we just watched.
Yes. Yeah. Absolutely. I mean, there's very, very exciting games across the board. The Bill versus AlSkyHigh match, definitely super memorable for me. That the very last game was crazy comeback. So, yeah, just a great series of games today, honestly. I'm excited for tomorrow.
Yeah, I'm sure tomorrow we'll have a bunch more fantastic games. We can take a look right now exactly which games those will be. And so we have the schedule. Match one will be the winner's decider from Group A, which is Nostam versus Amnesiac. Moving over to the winner's decider from Group B, which will be AlSkyHigh versus Snail. And then the lower bracket matchups from both groups, starting with Chucky versus Talion and WTY Bill versus Chess Dude. Any standout matches for you there, Savitz?
Well, I'm kind of excited to see the AlSkyHigh versus Snail. Like, Snail will have another shot tomorrow. How is he going to do when he's playing up against the Egg Paladin from AlSkyHigh? I think it's going to be fun to watch.
Very quickly, starting with you, Reynad, highlights of the day?
The Jiraxxus into Harrison top deck into the Jiraxxus deck winning. Definitely the biggest
awesome.
Highlight.
Savitz?
For today, I mean, I think the Warrior deck that we saw was really surprising to me personally, and I kind of liked seeing it in action. I'm looking forward to see how it does overall in this tournament tomorrow and the day after.
Awesome. Thank you, Reynad. Thank you, Savitz. Thanks to the rest of the crew. Thanks to all you guys for watching. Make sure you are back here tomorrow. We will have more fantastic action. See you then.